make an international tour and still say that I don't want to spend in dollar. To travel to Nepal and Bhutan. And the reason is that we have notification 17 which allows you to travel there and spend in rupees. So because of this only there are two countries with which you can exchange currency or in limited way you say that you are currency convertible. Otherwise not. So you have set notification 17 which says that in case of section 3, B, C and D of PEMA, transactions can be entered into Indian rupees and it will not apply. So if there's a Nepali resident and I want to treat him in rupee, what we see of 3, B, C and D, it will not apply. I'm not going much in detail because it's just for more of an academic purpose. Now friends, we have touched upon capital account transaction, the rationale that every capital account transaction will have a notification which is a self-contained code. There could be some definitions which are there in notifications which would be in addition to section 2. Now you have current account transactions. As Rasmeer Bhai also mentioned, we are open on current account transactions. India is almost open on current account transactions. If there is a transaction which is in the nature of current account, you will find that you can enter into free without any limits. There are few transactions on which there is a limit, but otherwise general cardinal principle is that current account transactions are usually freely permissible. Under GATT, General Agreement on Trade and Tariff with IMF, which monitors, India is a signatory and we says that we are open on current account transactions. Now this current and capital, again I am repeating, were not prevalent under PEMA. This is a brainchild under PEMA. And therefore, if it is a current account transaction, it is freely doable. And friends, bear this in mind. If you can convert capital into current account transaction, the entire scene will be. I say that you can convert it, it's not possible to convert that way. But let's take a case. We recently came across a case where there was a US resident, the NRI. Now, US NRI is into software IT industry there. He has a friend in India and he wants to outsource some work to Indian company. So he is requesting his friend that you incorporate a company or you incorporate whatever entity you want to set up. But I'll outsource some work to you. Now to outsource that work, he needs a place. He says that you acquire a place which would at least be in the capacity of 100 people to make them occupy. Now this requires huge amount of deposits to be given to landlord. Now Indian company, Indian partnership firm doesn't have this funds and neither Indian partner is or Indian friend is in a position nor is willing to lend money to landlord. Okay, so I don't want to block my money in that. Now how do you resolve this? Look at the capital account transaction scenario. There's a US company. US company can either have to make investment in India as foreign direct investment, we say that you can issue security. Or if it's an NRI, you can even become partner as a partner, partnership. Notification 24, notification 28. Right? But Indian party says, no, I don't want to share any of my profits with them. So partnership is ruled out. Or even foreign direct investment is ruled out. Now let's examine borrowing. If you say borrowing in foreign currency, he says that I don't want to risk foreign countries, then he has to lend money to India, partnership form or a private limited company. And if you go to notification 3, which is borrowing and lending in foreign currency, there are set rules on external commercial borrowing, you know, very, very strict rules. So you can't even fit there, because what you are going to do is that you are going to place deposit with landlord, which is a working capital, which is not a, if you look at ECB policy, it says that, you know, you will basically spend money for capital expansion, modernization of plant, basically it should result in generation of employment. You should create real assets. Even by borrowing. And Reserve Bank is very, very strict on it. Even though the limits have been expanded time and again for ECB. But when it comes to borrowing, they say we will allow only productive use. We won't allow you to use ECB for working capital. If it is a working capital use, you go to approval. And in such cases, it will be very difficult for this gentleman to seek an approval. Now, what do you do? Now, interestingly, as I mentioned, that facts are that this company is going to export software because it is outsourcing, right? So there's a possibility of raising export proceeds in advance. The FEMA says, notification 23 on export of goods and services, that Indian exporter can receive money in advance. And which is of the alternative? Okay. So if you can receive money as an export advance, provided that you export of goods within 1 year. You have to export that within 1 year. If it goes beyond, you seek an RBI approval. So what I'm trying to say is that, you know, if there's a possibility of converting capital account transaction as the receipt of fund or movement of funds, and if you want, like import advances. So there are set rules for remitting money overseas for advance imports. You will find plethora of circular on import of rough diamonds. India being importing rough diamond, and Surat, you know, or even Mumbai. So there are set rules for that kind of thing. The point is that, you know, you should see, is it possible to convert, and you will find entire gamut opening up. Sometimes you are left with no solution, it can lead to. The other point, and I touch upon right now since we are on current account, the non-resident Indian can lend in Indian rupees to firm or proprietorship funds, but not to private limited company. If you go to notification 4, which is on borrowing and lending in Indian rupee, it says non-resident Indian can lend to a firm or a proprietorship concern for own business purposes. But then there are restrictions on end use, that if such firm or proprietorship concern has received loan, one is on restriction on interest payment and what will be the tenure of loan and all that, but that firm in turn cannot onward lend money. You can't invest in real estate. So all these things are closed. Okay. So therefore, you look at advance import, advance exports, and luckily, even if in case there's an export which is issued as advance proceeds, there's a possibility of even paying interest on that. And the notification 23 prescribes within LIBOR plus 1% or 2%. The limits are. So you can even, they have notice that, you know, it's possible that you might even pay interest. So the thing is, you can receive this thing and do that. Now, again, you know, when you are examining this, now the words used in advance for exports are, export of goods must be shipped within 1 year. The software is not goods. So that's a challenge we have. Either you need to clarify. In my view, I will slightly take a liberal view, because it is not export of services. It is export of software, which is regulated. I'll be filing soft tax form with Reserve Bank of India, now which is available on online process. You need to go to Reserve Bank site and generate online that soft tax form, which will come with prefix number. So there's a quite bright chance to say that export of software would still be permissible for receiving advance packages. But if it is export of services, which is absolutely deregulated, today, chartered accountant and lawyers, if you are providing services to your overseas clients and you are raising invoice for foreign currency, there is no declaration to be filed. Export of services is still deregulated. Of course, they have mentioned that there is no declaration to be filed, but we want such exporter to receive payment within 6 months. But on export of services, there is no declaration to be filed. I just wanted to bring up this. Now, under current account, there are 3 schedules. 1, 2 and 3. This is current account rules. Unlike notification, you will find here they are known as current account rules. There is some prohibited transaction which is Schedule 1. You can't do such transaction. Now it is worded very vaguely. It says remittance out of lottery money. It is not remittance out of lottery money. Actually, you can't remit money to buy lottery overseas. Now UK is suppose a country which allows gambling or whatever, you know, is a free economy for gambling. But you and me today cannot remit money even under 25,000 erstwhile or 2 lakh or $75,000 to buy a lottery. You can't. You can't remit for racing, riding and all that. Remit is for the purchase of lottery ticket, everything is fine. So it says you cannot do that. Then you have, but you will find that, you know, interestingly, it says remittance for lottery is not allowed. Now you have seen that in India there is an online lottery business is flourishing. And all this technology was imported. Technology to create platform for online trading of lottery software, the IT system, the entire network was generally. Now probably we would have indigenized, but most of this lottery, which whoever players are there, generally it was definitely technology is imported. So you can import the technology. You you cannot enter into technical collaboration for such thing. Entering into collaboration for gambling, even technology collaboration, I am not saying financial collaboration, that means you are entering into a technological collaboration and you say that per lottery I'll pay you 10 paisa as a royalty. Per lottery sold in India, because of technology collaboration, you are entitled to 10 paisa per lottery on a rupee or say 1 rupee lottery, which is not enough. But I can import that, which is a kind of technology. I'm not entering into any collaboration. Then you have Schedule 2, which is says that, you know, it requires some kind of approval. So there are cultural rules and remittance for container retention, and I'll not go much into detail. In the next session, we are dealing with this. Then you have current account transaction Schedule 3, which is what more interesting to us. You will come across frequent transaction of this nature. Gift remittance exceeding $5,000 per remittance. Now Schedule 3 is list of the transactions which are permissible. In certain type of transaction, they have prescribed the limit. Means up to that limit you can do. Beyond that limit, go to RBI and seek approval. So it is gift remittance exceeding $5,000 per remitter, per donor, per account. Now this limit of 5,000 has been subsumed, it's been clubbed under 75,000, which is permissible for capital and current account. I mean, liberalized remittance. The release of exchange for meeting, expenses for medical treatment abroad exceeding just even, I think. Yeah. So this is the 75,000 scheme. Now I'll touch upon this capital account current account. You have seen the capital account transition and current account transition. We are fairly conversant now with these terms. Now what is capital account current account? We are hearing this term quite frequently. And many of you would be aware, basically it's a concept which says that I'm converting my capital assets in India, which is denominated Indian currency, and want to liquidate part of it, take it over abroad, and convert into some assets or process. And that is what is capital account convertibility. So for resident Indian, when you say capital account convertibility, it will apply to resident Indian and not to non-resident Indian. They will be governed by a country of that law. Like for example, NRI based out of US, US is fully convertible in capital. It's not for them. Capital convertibility is for we resident Indian. It says that today, 75,000 per financial year, I can convert my Indian assets into overseas assets. Again, subject to permissible capital account transaction or current account transaction. So I can't, even under 75,000 scheme, I can't buy lottery. I can't enter into overseas real construction trading business, because if you go to notification 120 dealing with outbound investment, this is prohibited. So you have to look at permissible capital account transaction. Okay, so this is what is capital account convertibility. I'll go to my banker, say that give me foreign exchange of $75,000. I want to invest in overseas company, be it unlisted or listed. As Asmin bhai said, you know, I'll touch upon that point also. So basically, and then current account convertibility, as I already mentioned, that India is fully convertible on current account because of Article 8 of IMF agreement, which we have entered in 1994, and we undertake that, you know, we are fully open on current
account.
Immovable properties, they have prohibited from, before 15th August 2013, it was permissible. So a lot of people have bought properties overseas under $2 lakh. We heard, you know, the Shah Rukh Khan owning a villa in Dubai, and the Dasmin Bhai said, you know, five of you come together, family member, you go there and acquire, and even wherever you want it. But as dollar started moving from 45 to 59, 60, 65, 80, 70, this was the time when these measures have been introduced, that you have curtailed the limit. That's what, you know, I said, you can't keep quiet. So they have curtailed the limit from $2 lakh to $75,000, and when they curtailed the limit on 14th August 2013, there was a circular which says that we will not allow $75,000 scheme for buying property. And they have used the word directly or indirectly. So if the intention is to buy overseas property and you say that I will float an overseas company, and the intention of that company is just to acquire property, I'll show some skeleton business, you know, I am just, you know, superficial business, and ultimate intention is to acquire overseas property and I am contributing capital, that is not allowed. They say it directly or in any manner. It could be trust structure or whatever. So, directly. So for to avoid or to preserve foreign exchange, we have moved to that stage. Now this is something, you know, we talked about how frequent and how dynamic is FEMA, and one of the method by which Reserve Bank keeps updating is through circular, which are known as EPDIRs. It is circular, which is known as the authorized person. EP stands for authorized persons, and DIR is directions. So EPDIR series circulars and master circulars. Now these are the directions, they call it, and these are issued to authorized persons. So authorized persons are the person who can deal in foreign issue. But ultimately, authorized persons are delegated with some power. So whatever is applicable, they are the kind of monitoring agency in between. But it will apply to anyone who wants to carry out that transaction. So you will have to, you will find that, you know, every time there are master, I mean, EPDIR circular being issued, the cutoff date is July to June. And Rajesh just now mentioned me that from July 13 till now, 120 circulars have been issued. 120. So this will, they keep on issuing circulars, and luckily you have master circulars, which are issued on 1st July of every year, which summarizes the entire gamut of circulars related to that point of time. So the best approach would be, you can, if at all you want to begin, go to master circular, understand in normal language, then go to notification. Read the circulars post master circular. Look at the relevant notification if at all it is out. At times there were delays in issuing notification. So EPDIR circular and notification go parallel. In fact, if notification should be out first and then should be EPDIR circular. But now there is a kind of almost parity. The dates of issue of EPDIR circulars and notification more or less are same, because Supreme Court has fired Reserve Bank of India that you have not been issuing notification, and after that, there are a plethora of notifications being issued for which EPDIRs were already in public domain, but notifications were not available. So you will find that there are some gaps, notification 105, and suddenly you will find notification 115, which make a 10 key letter. So they were not issued earlier, they were issued, but whatever. Because notification, what I understand is, I am not an advocate, but what it requires a process of parliament passing and all that. It will take time, but EPDIR is within the purview of Reserve Bank and the issue. Now EPDIR circular, though it's a circular, unlike CBDT circular, which is only binding on department, it has a ban. Because if you go to section 13, which talks about penalties, it says even contravention of directions, and direction would be EPDIR. So you can't take a view that, you know, it is an EPDIR circular which is holding a particular view, and if I am not following that view, I should not be, no penalty should be imposed on me. That will not hold good, because if you read section 13, it says contravention of notification, act, notification, and even direction. And directions are these directions. Now let's look at residential status, another very important aspect of FEMA, and that is residential status. I just try to correlate this concept with the Income Tax Act to make it things more clear. So you have same concept under FEMA. The residential status is of two types: person resident in India and person resident outside India. So you have resident and non-resident. Unlike R but NOR, this concept is not there under FEMA. Under FEMA, the citizenship was considered as the deciding factor, whereas FEMA does not lay emphasis on citizenship. FERA was citizenship centric and FEMA is resident centric. The meaning is that, say for example, Bill Clinton, the ex-president of US, he comes to India, he likes India, he is in India for uncertain period, he finds that, you know, I want to live my entire life here. Request Hillary, drop your election process and all that to settle in. Both of them are here, and they are, in a way, they are in India, not doing any business, vocation or profession, but still in India, and they want to settle in India. Under FEMA, they become resident, and they are allowed to acquire immovable property. But FEMA didn't allow. It was concentrated on citizenship. Now, US, Bill Clinton, even if he has not surrendered US citizenship, he can acquire immovable property in India because he becomes resident of India. Non-resident Indians are always allowed to acquire property in India. But otherwise, no foreigner is allowed. And that's why, you know, there is no speculative activity in India. But if you want to, a foreigner wants to acquire property in India, he has to become resident in India. Okay? Let's look at the definition. It says it is 2V1, residing person resident in India means residing in India for more than 182 days during the course of preceding financial year, but does not include. So you are looking at preceding financial year, unlike the current or relevant financial year. You go back to preceding financial year and say that you are in India for more than 182 days for person resident in India, but it says it does not include going out of India or staying outside India for employment, for business or vocation, or for any other purpose in such circumstances as would indicate his intention to stay outside India for uncertainty. So here what matters is the not just number of days in India, but intention. And while deciding residential status, specifically for non-resident, I mean to decide whether somebody is NRI or not under FEMA, one has to see. For example, a person who is in India throughout his life, okay, and he gets a job overseas. Say for example, he is recently qualified from IIT and he was throughout his life in India. Okay. He is definitely, if you say he was in preceding financial year, 182 days or more in India, now he takes up a job overseas. And that, assume for a while, in January 2014, he leaves India. So under Income Tax Act for 11 financial year, March 14, he would be resident. But under FEMA, he would become non-resident. The reason is he has left outside India, going out of India or staying outside India for taking up employment. He has gone to take up employment. And why there is a reason to do prescribe so, otherwise it will result into chaos. If you say that we will examine the residential status only at the year end, that is on 31st March, similar to income tax. If he takes up employment overseas, say in Microsoft, and Microsoft issues a salary check or he wants to transfer money to his bank account. Today you and me, there's a restriction on opening up a foreign currency account by person resident in India. If you treat that person as a person resident in India, there will be restriction on him to open foreign currency account. He even can't make other payments. So you got the logic now. The person intention matters. The moment I have left India for employment, I will become non-resident irrespective of my number of days. Similarly for carrying business or vocation. So it is not going out of India on a business visa, but I am living in India. I'm living in India, I want to set up my business or vocation process. That's why I'll become non-resident. Or in such circumstances, as would indicate his intention to stay outside India. So I'm neither living on employment nor on business or vocation, but I'm going out of India. And then would say that, you know, like for example, UAE, which gives you resident visa. Son is working in UAE and he calls his father to come back. Because there's nobody to take care in India, you also join us. And he goes there on resident visa and he's not doing nothing. No employment, no visa, but his intention is to stay and he's there for a prolonged period. That would make him non-resident even at the time.
How about students?
Students will also be on the same way. Yeah, they have amended circular 45 is there, yeah. But now student, because most of the time, I don't remember the year, but there was a circular 45 of 2004, 5 or 6, because they found that it was creating real difficulties because students used to take job over there. Okay, and maybe if you are on student visa, technically under US law or other law, you are not allowed to take up job, but you were taking up job. And those were paid officially also. There is nothing like cash checking abroad. So how do you deal with that situation? The Reserve Bank clarified that student living would be regarded as, though the act is not amended, a good thing you brought to my notice, that student will be regarded as a non-resident. Reverse way. It says person resident in India coming to India. Just make an amendment in the presentation, it is shown as staying outside India, in the second square. Actually, it should be coming to India or staying in India. Coming to India or staying in India, otherwise than for taking up employment, for carrying business or vocation, or for any other purpose in such circumstances, as would indicate his intention to stay in India for uncertainty. So if I am coming up for employment in India, I will become resident. If I am coming for business or vocation in India, I will become resident from day one under FEMA. Under income tax, it would be a different situation, but under FEMA, I would become resident from day one. Or in such circumstances, as would indicate my intention. So I am in India again, like father going with family. Here is a case where somebody is coming to India and the circumstances would justify, would lead to a situation that is for uncertainty.
Yeah.
Can you please louder? know, here also, if you say person resident in India, one would be extra cautious to regard him as a resident. As I told you, citizenship concept is given go by. So typically dealing with immovable property, if you say that, you know, I have taken up employment in India, I am in India for January, I am coming to India on January 1 and I want to take up employment, and so I am resident at the time, I immediately say next day I want to acquire property. That is what is RBI looks at very suspiciously. And there is a FAQ, old FAQ, I think I have kept here. This is the slide. So if you go through this, it says that, you know, you, in that case, you also comply with preceding years 182 condition. Okay? So if you say that, you know, I am a resident because I am taking the employment in India, again the same concept will apply. Because today non-resident cannot open bank account in India. But he becomes resident, he is taking the employment, he becomes resident, he can apply bank account with Indian banks. Right? INR. So you will have to see FEMA, when since you are raising that, now you are confused with is resident or non-resident. Right? Now you could say is both. The situation otherwise is resident, but FEMA is a law which tries to regulate transactions. So what you have to apply in your mind is that what is the type of transaction which he wants to carry out. Under going by section 2B, he becomes resident because he has taken up employment in India. Now he wants to open bank account, he would be. But if you say he wants to acquire immovable property in India, it's a capital account transaction, right? It's a transaction, capital account transaction. Go to notification 21, try to see, and then go to this FAQs and somewhere, what is guidance available. Otherwise, he can very well apply. But Reserve Bank is of the view that in case of acquisition of immovable property, the 182 days condition must be complied. And again, if you are from few countries like China and other countries, as we see, proceed for it, you are not allowed.
Suppose a foreigner.
Yeah.
Expatriate come for employment in India,
when
they open a foreign
currency account. See, this last bullet. This is Schedule 3 of current account rules. Okay, well, we looked at current account rules, Schedule 1, 2, and 3. I'm just reading for whatever is mentioned. Schedule 3 of current account transaction rules specifying transaction which require prior RBI approval includes, now this includes, remittance made for remittance of close relatives abroad. Your question is, can you open foreign currency account?
Yeah.
So he's receiving salary in Indian rupees. Yeah. His family is there.
Okay.
So this is what is covered. He says, you can remit out of that salary. And there are rules how much you can remit immediately. So even though he is a resident, because he is an expatriate, he has taken up employment in India, but Schedule 3, this clause allows him to remit for maintenance of close relatives abroad.
For example, the company head office
in
abroad, so
that
directly comes in the foreign currency, can it be okay for
him? Then you have to go to the what kind of visa is in India.
What visa?
If it is an employment visa, then I am afraid. I mean, I would want that they should have, first of all, you are establishing a branch in India. The foreign company has, in a way, by deputing its employee, even though you are not set up under, you are not done it approval, because setting up a branch in India requires prior approval. If you are not done under that route, filing of form FNC 1 and seeking prior approval of RBI, because you have already deputed a person, he is working in India. So you have to open bank account in India and remit salary to branch account and let branch print that salary to that employee. Now,
one question, like this exception period on returning and migration.
Right.
So on returning, the only 182 days that is to be applied only for the immovable property, that the threshold of 182. Because the moment the person arrives in India for any of the three reasons, he will require to open the bank account, he would require to carry out the transaction in Indian rupee. So the only for the purpose of acquisition of immovable property, that 182 days clause will apply, or for all these three purposes, the moment he touches the land.
Even for acquisition of making portfolio investment, I don't think by becoming resident, he can invest in Indian
securities. That means the moment he touches the land, the resident status is going to be changed from person resident.
Provided all three terms.
Yeah, if he falls in any of the three exceptions.
An uncertain period would only be determined by facts and circumstances. You can't decide as on the date of arrival.
Okay.
See, uncertain period is, it will take some time. For example, there was a factual case probably in Kottayam, which is known for cancer treatment.
Right.
So,